The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Krista Brown, training specialist with the APS Technical Assistance Resource Center, APS TARC, and I want to welcome you to our webinar, Opioid Misuse and Adult Maltreatment, Promising Practices Update from Montana and Nevada, with Tammy Sever, Agnes Francis, Sharysse Boer, and they're all from the state of Nevada, Aging and Disability Services Division, APS, and Trevor Tangen, Adult Protective Services Bureau Chief, Montana Department of Health and Human Services. And I'm going to introduce our presenters in a moment. But before that, next slide. Before we get started, I'd like to share a little bit of information. This webinar is being hosted by the APS TARC, which is a project of the U.S. Administration for Community Living, Administration on Aging, Department of Health and Human Services, and administered by WRMA Incorporated. Contractors' findings, conclusions, and points of view do not necessarily represent the official policy of the federal government. Next slide. The APS TARC works with states to enhance the effectiveness of APS programs by working with partners on use of data and analytics, applying research and evaluation to practice, and encouraging the use of innovative practices and strategies. We're here to help APS programs in any way we can. Just reach out to us using the contact information that will be displayed at the end of the webinar. Next slide. The APS TARC presents monthly peer-to-peer calls. These calls provide a forum for workers, supervisors, managers, and administrators to dialogue and share ideas with each other about the issues and concerns facing APS programs today. The calls are held the second, third, or fourth Wednesday of each month, depending on which peer group you would like to attend. Registration information is sent via the APS listserv each month. Please email us if you are not a listserv member and would like to receive registration information. And again, we'll have contact information at the end of the webinar. Next slide. Now on to some housekeeping. A handout of today's slide is available for download in the handout section of the webinar control panel, and you may download this at any time. Please use your computer speakers to access audio for this webinar. If you experience audio problems due to internet connection speeds or hardware issues, we highly recommend that you exit and re-log in and see if that helps. Next slide. At any point in the webinar, you can post questions or share comments with the presenters by using your question box in your webinar control panel. And we're going to have a Q&A time at the end, and we'll try to get to as many questions as possible. This presentation is being recorded and will be posted to the TARC website at a later date, along with a copy of the slides. And we'll let all registrants and everyone know when that is online. Everyone attending today will receive an email in about 24 hours with a link to download your certificate of attendance. And lastly, when prompted, please go ahead and take our brief webinar survey. We really love to hear from you. So next slide. Before we introduce our presenters, we want to get a sense of who you are. And I'm going to launch a bit of a poll. Which of the following categories do you identify with the most? And you'll see your selections there on the screen. So go ahead and we'll take a couple seconds to get a sense of you if you want to vote. The votes are coming in. All right. Let's take a couple more seconds and we'll go ahead and close the polling. All right, about 75% people have voted, and let me share the results. And we are about half APS. About 16% social services professionals, and 5% medical, 2% legal, and a lot of other. Well, welcome everyone. We're really happy to have you here today. Next slide. So it is my great pleasure to introduce what I call the dream team, our presenters today. We have Tammy Sever, Agnes Francis, and Sharysse Boer. They're all from the State of Nevada Aging and Disability Services Division, APS. Tammy is the Social Services Chief 2, Agnes is Management Analyst 2, and Sharysse is Business Project Specialist, and of course, Trevor Tangen, Adult Protective Services Bureau Chief, Montana Department of Public Health and Human Services. I'm going to hand it on over to Tammy to get us started. Next slide.
Good afternoon, everyone. And on behalf of myself and the co-presenters, Agnes, Sharysse, and Trevor, I just want to have a few thank yous out there. First of all, I want to thank Krista for reaching out to us and giving us this opportunity. We'd like to thank the Administration for Community Living on giving us this opportunity and giving us the grant funding. We'd also like to thank, as I'm looking at the attendees, all 152 of you that have registered for this. This has been a great opportunity for us, and we are excited to share our work with you this afternoon. Next slide. So over the next couple slides, we're going to share the grant project objectives with you. Next slide. So the ACL project for the opioid misuse started on 9/1/2020 and through 8/31/2022. It's hard to believe that it's been about a year and a half, and we're down to the last 6 months of this project. The objectives for the state of Nevada included to provide outreach to community through the development of a multifaceted awareness campaign and media presence to raise awareness for older adults and systemic resources to better the interrelationship of elder abuse and opioid misuse. So in order to meet that objective, we had to partner with several people. And for this first objective, we partnered with KPS3, an advertising agency, to help us with our PSAs and just the all over of the awareness campaign. The second objective was to develop a screening tool and provide training to APS staff for the development of specific training modules on the identification of opioid misuse and when to make a referral to the Adult Protective Service Mental Health Counselor. So we reached out to the Center for Application of Substance Abuse Technology, also known as CASAT, and they helped us a great deal with providing us the training and information on opioid misuse. To be perfectly honest with you, when we applying for this grant and when we were awarded, we were excited, but we were both very nervous too, because a lot of us really didn't know a lot about opioid misuse. So our third objective was to identify community partners and streamline referrals to services. And with that, we used our Adult Protective Service Mental Health Counselors and also CASAT. The State of Nevada Adult Protective Services, we have two mental health counselors, one in Las Vegas that serves the southern half of the state, and then we have another mental health counselor up in north in our Reno office who helps with in the northern area. So finally, we realized we had to track the opioid-related APS cases, including client and alleged perpetrator data. And with alleged perpetrator in the state of Nevada, we refer to them as persons of interest. And we also wanted the client service referral data regarding opioid misuse. So in order to accomplish this, we most definitely appreciate and needed our project manager, Sharysse, who you will hear speak in a few minutes, Aging and Disabilities Division's IT department, And we also needed WellSky, which is our program, as we were going to need to add some things into our database. Next slide, please.
Hello, everybody. It's Trevor from Montana. Just going through our objectives for our state. Objective one was document the problem and severity of opioid and substance misuse problems for both the alleged victim, AV, and alleged perpetrator, AP. Facilitate and document service delivery with a new service plan monitor team to document the substance misuse services referred and facilitate receipt of services for both the AV and AP. And then lastly, measure the outcomes. And to accomplish this goal, we partnered with Purdue University and the University of Illinois Chicago to act as our researchers. They are currently compiling all of our data and shortly will tell us soon here what it all means. Jump Technology Services helped build our screening tools to accomplish this. And then the Montana Area Agencies on Aging Association, otherwise known as M4A, helped us by helping us with our satisfaction surveys at the conclusion of our reports. Next slide, please.
Over the next couple slides, we are going to talk about the challenges and lessons learned from our project launch. As I'm sure everybody knows, with any project we do, there's always some challenges, but fortunately, we also learn lessons from those challenges. Next slide. So the challenges for the state of Nevada was small project launch delays. As I stated before, the grant started on 9/1. We did not get approval to use the funds until October 22nd of 2020. We had to spend some time developing the content for the awareness campaign. We were looking at doing public service announcements, so we know we needed to get a volunteer to tell their story on camera. And we knew we were going to have to take some time to develop the content of what we wanted those PSAs to say. And third, we needed to develop a screening tool, our selected screening tool for our staff to use. So the lessons learned account for all unforeseen delays related to, you know, necessary agency approval. We learned that we need to allow ample time to review content and have regular recurring meetings set up ahead of time. I think that was one of the greatest things about this, this project and other projects that Nevada does is APS has a great team that we work together, myself, Agnes, Sharysse, we have Elizabeth McCurdy and Robin Tejada, who are our managers for APS. We had our mental health counselors, a mental health counselor in Southern Nevada help out, Christy Ackman, and our QA manager, Stephanie Schneider, all in this, our team. So it really helped facilitate all our objectives that we wanted to do. And finally, we knew we needed a subject matter on the team necessary for guidance on the topic of opioid misuse. Next slide.
And for Montana, some challenges that we faced: project launch delays, the state approval processes and establishing contracts, data collection tools. Building data collection tools in their IT system takes time. Hiring additional staff, so the four social service workers, as well as our two M4A workers that we brought on for the project. And currently, we have two admin staff at Montana Adult Protective Services. So in conjunction with running the Bureau, it's a lot of work, and it did take some time for us to get launched and moving in this project. Lessons learned: account for unforeseen delays related to necessary agency approvals. Test early, test often for data fidelity. Hire the right person and retain the workforce has been challenging during the pandemic. So in Montana, we did not start collecting data until October of 2021 is when we were up and running. And some additional challenges just to include from up above include circumstances where the AV and AP were not successfully connected with services, could not remember the services referred, and in some cases, depending on the area, services were not available. It has been difficult to identify those with opioid-specific issues. Oftentimes, only general substance abuse can be identified or is simply suspected. And given the propensity of substance abuse disorder to fuel the type of cases that APS receives, it's important to identify substance abuse impacts on APS cases. Next slide, please.
Okay, so next we're going to talk about the screening tools, development, and how we launch those with our investigators. Next slide. So in the state of Nevada, our adult protective services, we have a centralized intake unit. They are based in Las Vegas and they take calls statewide, either a local number for Clark County, but then we also have a toll-free number for outside of the Clark County area. So related to objective one, we wanted to collect data that reflected the reporter's perception of opioid use misuse from either the client or, it says POI, again, as the person of interest. So at intake, we have our intake workers just ask two very basic questions on any report they take. The first question is, does the reporter suspect the client of an opioid misuse? Very simple answer, yes, no, unknown. And also, does the reporter suspect a person of interest of opioid misuse? Those answers would be yes, no, and unknown. And then if we had a self-neglect case, it would be noted as a self-neglect because if we don't consider our client when it's a self-neglect, we don't consider them a person of interest. Just up above there, it says excluding information or referrals. So those are our INR calls. Our intake do receive calls looking for personal care assistance, legal aid assistance. So when they just refer out to other community resources, they do not do this, these two intake questions. Next slide. So as we talked about what screening tool we were going to use and how we were going to go about it and how the social workers and our investigators were going to speak to their clients about this, Christy Ackman, our mental health counselor, she made a sample script. So we held a staff meeting and Christy and I role played. I as a client and she as a social worker, and we just went through these list of questions. Now, we told the social workers investigators, we have social workers and we also have adult rights specialists that do investigations, that they didn't need to follow this word by word. This was just to help them develop something that flowed with them and made them feel comfortable in speaking to the client about possible opioid misuse. And next slide.
This is the Nevada APS opioid questionnaire as implemented in our WellSky system. Once the decision was made to not utilize the DAST-10 screening tool, the APS team evaluated several other screening tools. After this review, we decided to write a questionnaire specific to Nevada APS. The opioid questionnaire was developed to allow APS investigators to quickly identify possible opioid misuse for the client or someone in the client's household.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Sharysse. In addition, our ADSD IT department was able to help implement this tool in WellSky. We are really fortunate to have a knowledgeable and trained IT department who can help us implement changes without involvement from the vendor. What's great is this results in a lot of time and cost savings on the projects. In addition, APS worked with the ADSD IT department to develop new reports and update existing reports in order to incorporate and accurately capture opioid misuse data. This work included writing a gap analysis document to specify the report requirements. To date, We've developed 7 new reports, 7 existing reports were updated, and 3 reports are still in the development phase. The work on the 7 new reports was significantly more difficult than on the existing reports, since the layout and design is new, as opposed to working with reports that have already been developed. Again, we are fortunate to have an expert level Nevada ADSD report developer helping us, as well as myself, the project manager. We worked together on the development. We also had validation testing from several members of the APS team to successfully complete the reports we've been working on. Next slide, please.
So for Montana, we didn't implement our screening tool at our intake level. With our jump technology services, you can, however, if the allegation is relating to substance abuse, you still are able to put that in there. But the additional screening we didn't put on to our intake staff. We had that implemented with our field staff, our investigators, as they're out there talking with folks and doing the investigations. If there were indications of opioid abuse, a service plan was created, and service plans were followed up by our social service workers and then our M4A staff 30, 60, and 90 days after the investigation was closed. Next slide, please. So in addition to the text above, kind of gives you a layout of how we walked through this. Montana implemented a substance disorder screener, or otherwise known as SDSCR, at the investigator level, and was utilized during the investigation as staff met with the alleged victim or alleged perpetrator. The substance disorder screener was not limited to opioid-related questions. Instead, there were broad questions about alcohol and drug use, which we will see on the next slide. It was important for our investigators to make the screening questions free-flowing during the conversation, so it was not assumed that the investigator believed the person was a drug or alcohol abuser. Saying things like, I have a set of questions that we review with everybody whom we interview, and I would like to go over them with you, help the person understand they are not being signaled out or suspected of drug and alcohol abuse by the investigator. Next slide, please. So you can see our SDSCR screener, our substance disorder screener here with the bank of questions. If any questions in this screener were answered yes in the past month or in the past 2 to 12 month columns, the investigator moved to the opioid disorder screener, otherwise known as the ODS, which we'll see on the next slide. Next slide, please. So training, all cases should report this information at pretest by the investigator. So we did this in a pretest format after the initial visit with the alleged victim or the alleged perpetrator. Programming the form should have at risk adult and alleged perpetrator pretest. It could be built together with the SDSCR pretest. And data extraction by case and list the following in one row: at risk adult and alleged perpetrator pretest could be built together with the SDSCR pretest. Some instructions, the following questions about your prior use of opioids. For each question, please indicate yes or no as it applies to you. Your use during the last 12 months. Below are commonly used opioids with a few street names, though there are many more drugs and many more names. So as you can see, the list of questions that we have here, this is what our investigators would ask of the alleged perpetrator or the alleged victim. And then scoring, so columns A through H, if there's any answered yes, you can skip down to the next column of questions, which would be the 2 through 8. And then if you can see that text, the scoring, if you have 3 or more coded yes, then we would mark that for an opioid disorder. If the total is 2 or less, code no for opioid disorder. Next slide, please.
Thank you. Okay, so next we're going to talk about the challenges and lessons learned from our project implementation. Next slide. So some of our challenges were as far as APS staffing. We had difficulty scheduling new trainings. With APS in Nevada, we are very fortunate that we are able to provide trainings for our staff. But you know, having our regular scheduled trainings and these new trainings and our investigators trying to go out there and doing a regular job was a little bit difficult. In the beginning, there was a little, we had the difficulty with the timing of the administering of the opioid questionnaire. Staff just really weren't feeling comfortable when they should start asking from the beginning of the conversation, middle, end. And then, of course, there is that stigma around the word opioid. So the lessons learned is, on this would be the opioid questionnaire integrated the natural part of the investigation. So our social workers and our adult rights specialists, they worked it on their own and developed on what felt comfortable for them to when to start talking about opioid. Also, the term pain medication started to be used and seemed to remove that stigma of the word opioid. So we, under our awareness campaign content, we had to find out who we were going to get to do these films. So we were fortunate, an adult protective services social worker in our Reno office, Courtney Wilson, it says here that she was she volunteered to be filmed, but I'm pretty sure with my discussion with her, it was kind of more she was voluntold to do the PSA, but she did a great job. We've had issues with doing a Google ad because of the mention of opioids. I guess that's some kind of censored word. Some lessons learned is the APS mental health counselor is an expert on the team, and her expertise is necessary for help the accuracy of our outreach content. So she helped us develop what we were going to talk about in our PSAs. And Agnes did mention this briefly a few minutes ago, but with the copyright expense. So we were all prepared to use the DAS-10. We trained our staff, we were ready for it. We were just about to ask WellSky to put this into our system. And lo and behold, we found out that there was a copyright on this screening tool, and it had an expense. And so we had to go back to the drawing board and do our own questionnaire. So then that kind of delayed us being able to get the questionnaire started. So just a lesson learned for us and give you all a tidbit of information is make sure you check on copyrights and costs of any online source. You're ever gonna do anything to prevent any project delays. And then again, additional work. We had to, like I said, develop our own questionnaire after that. Next slide.
Oh, did we lose you? Tammy, can you hear us?
No, I'm sorry. Yeah, sorry.
Oh, yeah, that's okay.
So part of this is just two copies you can see of our awareness campaign content. One is on our website to the left, and then to the right is just a screenshot of our social worker Courtney Wilson doing her her PSA, and it was titled "How Opioid Misuse Can Impact Anyone: Why It's Important to Report Vulnerable Adult Abuse Related to Opioid Misuse." And she did talk about a case that she had. A lot of it was mixed into some other stories, and of course, names changed so that nobody could figure out what we were, who we were talking about. But it was excellent. What's exciting is I do see on Facebook this ad pop up a lot on my feed, and so I do get to see that. Next slide.
So right here on the screen, you can see a flyer, and with the help of our marketing vendor, KPS3, Nevada APS designed this informational flyer for our APS clients. The challenge with designing the flyer and other outreach content was deciding which information to include and ensuring that person-centered language is used. The link to this flyer is located on our apsgethelp.com website, and also our investigators hand out this flyer to the clients if the client is willing to accept the flyer. The website, as you can see on the left, also contains links to other resources. Next slide, please. Nevada APS worked with CASAT to determine relevant training topics. The purpose of these trainings was to educate our APS staff on the identification of opioid misuse and when to make a referral to the APS mental health counselor. The challenges included developing the content and scheduling the trainings virtually due to COVID. And as well, these trainings are also available as webinars to our new staff so they can watch them once they're hired. We were able to hold one in-person training in Las Vegas, which was quite the feat. The training was also attended virtually by our staff in the Northern Nevada. The drug awareness and detection in adult protective services was presented by Sergeant Slattery with Southern Nevada High Impact Narcotics Task Force. This training focused on drug awareness, identification, trends, and safety. The training was designed to assist APS investigators with identifying potentially dangerous drugs and drug labs during home visits. Next slide, please.
So after Sergeant Slattery's great presentation for our staff, we all realized that there are tons of medications out there that are considered an opioid. And our investigators had requested if there was any way we could come up with some type of guide to help them when, you know, they're looking at medications. We worked with CASAT, as I had earlier mentioned, and they helped us develop this quick guide to opioids that our staff carries with them so that they are able to use it as a guide as they're looking at medications and to see if indeed anyone is taking any type of opioid medication. I know you all have access to this slide, so it is very interesting if you want to look at it and just see all the different types of medications that is considered an opioid and how many different varieties it comes. And next slide, please.
Great. So challenges and lessons learned from project implementation for Montana. Challenges, APS staff training. So difficulty with motivating the administration of the opioid questions and recognizing opioid abuse. So I will say we ask a lot of our staff, our investigators and intake, social service workers across the board. We ask a ton from them. And this was, you know, trying to get the buy-in so this wasn't just seen as another screener that has to be completed in an investigation. That was challenging, but I believe that we got there. And just through training and discussion with our staff and the importance of this project, hiring staff, so new positions created did not have established job description. So our social service workers and our partners with M4A was really just implementing and creating job descriptions. There was no policy procedure manual to work through. So it was kind of flying by the seat of your pants in some scenarios and just seeing the best way to see this through. And so we had quite a few staff that helped us with this, and they were up to the challenge and have done a great job. Leadership changes, so unexpected leave of key personnel that were involved in this project. We've had that. Lessons learned, specific training with narcotic chief to integrate asking opioid questions as part of the investigation. So just making it a smooth flow in the conversation, not something that's singled out and it's just it, but integrated fluidly into the conversation when we're developing our case and gathering information as we go along. contract with M4A to carry out follow-up surveys and satisfaction ratings with at-risk adults. So we found M4A and they have been able to pick up a lot of this work for us, which was integral in this project. Involve more key personnel in the project and keep detailed documentation on progress. So as we have folks that leave the Bureau, just making it so it's easy for the next person to take up the project and continue forward. This project has highlighted opportunities to improve upon follow-up with clients and providers and the need to identify the appropriate entity to provide the follow-up. As the clients sometimes face challenges in connecting with referrals on their own and instances where providers fail to reach out to those APS has referred, a real opportunity does exist to create a bridge for those in need. Next slide, please. So one of the trainings that we had our folks go through, we asked the Montana Department of Criminal Investigations Narcotics Division, the bureau chief in that department, we asked him to provide some training to Montana, and the training helped staff recognize the signs and symptoms of opioid abuse, drug identification, and commonly used drug paraphernalia. There was further department training utilizing role players, which took a couple of us out of our comfort zones, getting in a role player scenario. But this also provided staff with further tools to be able to implement the screening questions during investigation. And again, just make it a smooth flow of conversation. We do have quite a few of our investigators who are prior law enforcement, whether it's probation and parole, sheriff's office, PDs, and it was very easy for them to just implement this into their conversations with folks because they have done it regularly in times past. So we've leaned on them as well to help train our other staff on just making it a smooth conversation. Next slide, please.
All right, so we're going to present the data for the year one of the grant. Next slide, please. All right, so prior to the start of this project, Nevada APS was not able to track incidents of maltreatment related to possible opioid misuse. Through the addition of these two new intake questions, does the reporter suspect client of opioid misuse? And does the reporter suspect a POI of opioid misuse? Nevada APS can now track the number of intake reports related to possible opioid misuse. The graphs here represent data from May 1st through November 30th, 2021. And as you can see, approximately 1.7% of reporters suspected a client or POI of opioid misuse. With new questions and forms added to our system, WellSky, the APS team recognized that data entry errors, such as missing data and inaccurate data selection, would need to be addressed quickly and efficiently to prevent these errors from continuing to occur. Nevada APS identifies data errors for correction through the use of weekly investigation and intake error reports, NAMER's case component audit report, and summary calculations. This process resulted in substantial data error reductions since we started collecting the data in May. Next slide, please. So here's our data regarding the outcome of the opioid questionnaire. And again, the data is from May 2021 through November 2021. The main challenge with the opioid questionnaire, as Tammy mentioned earlier, was that the APS clients were not always willing to answer it during the investigation. And our investigators had to learn how to ask the questions and when would be the best time to ask them so that it flowed naturally as part of their conversation. In June of 2021, which is when we deployed the questionnaire, only 39% of the questionnaires were answered by our clients. By November, this increased to 56%. And we have an average of 46% of attempted questionnaires that were answered by our clients. This is likely, again, due to the APS investigators becoming more comfortable with administering the questionnaire. One of the lessons learned from this challenge is that when you implement a new tool, it takes time for staff to become proficient and comfortable using it, It is also important to continue to have discussions with staff about the new tool and continue educating staff on how to use this tool. Next slide, please.
So for this slide, the NAMRS category of behavioral health screening or diagnosis is substance use disorder. In order to track opioid misuse related cases, APS revised this selection to include more detailed options of substance use disorder dash opioid and substance use disorder dash other. On May 1st of 2021, substance use screening dash opioid was added to capture the client's answers to the opioid questionnaire. This was an important addition for tracking purposes. Additionally, the NAMRS behavioral health screening or diagnosis question for the alleged perpetrator, or as we call them in Nevada, the person of interest, was added to the WellSky system in April of 2021. Nevada APS is reporting this case component data on the federal fiscal year 2021 submission. From May 1st through November 30th of 2021, 4.2% of clients who answered the opioid questionnaire answered the opioid questions in a manner that indicated misuse of opioids, as you'll see on the graph here. From May 1st through November 30th, none of the POIs were willing to answer the opioid questionnaire. Our project team recognized this was an area of an improvement. And since then, we've collaborated with the state of Montana, Trevor's team, to understand their process when interviewing persons of interest with opioid misuse. And as Trevor mentioned, a lot of his team has experience with law enforcement. So we're hoping to get help through their experience in our future project to get more results when working with POIs and administering the opioid questionnaire. Next slide, please.
Right, so this first set of data is relating to our alleged victims. And as we kind of talked about before, in Montana, we started with the substance abuse screener, which was more of generalized topics about substance abuse, which included alcohol or any other drugs. And if we had indicated findings on those, then we would move to the opioid screening. So as it relates to the alleged victim, we had 76.1% success rate with our substance abuse screening. And then as it from those, we 33.8% success rate in the opioid abuse screening. Investigations is the count of clients who had an investigation of abuse, neglect, or exploitation. And LEAPS allows companion cases, but our investigation count is always the count of alleged victims on those reports, not the case itself. So staff were trained on these screening tools in late August, and cases are expected to be closed in Montana APS within 60 days. So we looked at cases that closed between October and December to ensure that all cases investigated had an opportunity to be screened. There may still be a small percentage that closed in early October, which missed the rollout of the tools just because those clients had already been interviewed. Next slide, please. So this is data as it relates to the alleged perpetrator. Of the 1,267 investigations completed, alleged perpetrators had screenings in 22.9% of the reports. That's that substance abuse screener. And then more than half of those, 52%, had screenings in the subsequent opioid screening. So we have had a bit of success in asking our alleged perpetrators and getting some buy-in and completing these. And as Nevada stated, we're happy to partner with them and share our successes and absolutely vice versa. So we're gonna be working through that. We would like to get our numbers up a little higher, and that's just gonna require some more staff training from our folks who are really good at implementing these into their questions, and then just getting that across the team of Montana APS. It is a tough thing. Your investigator's already coming at the alleged perpetrator with an allegation of sorts, and then to have to ask them about substance use, it is challenging to get them to cooperate. But we have had some success and hoping to get better as we go along. Next slide, please. So while this report summary reflects only cases closed between October and December, this chart highlights the increase in referrals documented, which then generate the following activities and subsequent intervals. So the at-risk adult satisfaction surveys, the 30-day from initial case, 30-day follow-up from the completion of satisfaction surveys, 60-day follow-up, and 90-day follow-up. So training with staff, not only in the documentation of referrals, but also the processes for warm handoff, resulted in increased documentation of referrals. The data for at-risk adult satisfaction can inform the effectiveness of the program and its referral management. Next slide, please.
Thank you. So I know you're all wondering what we're doing now and what's next for the remainder of this grant project. So we're going to spend a couple minutes letting you all know. Please, next slide. So for the state of Nevada, for our project year two activities, next month, our adult protective services staff is going to receive advanced motivational interviewing training. We will also receive training for trauma-informed care, which will include ACEs, which stands for the Advanced Childhood Experiences. We are working with CASAT with the mandated reporting training. What we are doing is we are developing different trainings that target different audiences and mandated reporters, social workers, emergency room personnel, EMS, hospitals, and law enforcement. The target date for the curriculum to be completed is March. And we are hoping to get it online as a self-paced course in May of this year. And we're working to complete a flyer on how to report to APS. We're also going to be looking at refreshing the content on our digital ads. I did forget to add on one of our PSAs, we also had the opportunity for the sheriff of Story County, which is in rural Nevada. He also did a PSA for us, so we really appreciated that. We're gonna focus additional efforts on our search engine for Facebook and Google. And of course, our data monitoring, doing a quarterly review of opioid misuse data. And we are truly, truly looking forward to our continued collaboration with the state of Montana. It's been a real pleasure working with them to get this webinar designed. Next slide.
And I'll say the same. It's been an absolute pleasure working with Nevada and getting to know the team there. And it's opened up some doors for us to collaborate on things in the future and providing training to each of our staff. So it's been awesome working through this with them. And so some year activities for year two activities for Montana, data collection, APS investigators continue to use the questionnaires, become more fluid with them. Evaluators investigate consistency and documentation of questionnaires, staff free training on the questionnaires, use during case investigation. So new staff receiving training on how to use the questionnaires and existing staff benefit from retraining. And then data analysis, so our evaluators examining the opioid problems in the state of Montana and reporting findings. And currently our researchers with Purdue and University of Illinois Chicago are analyzing our data. We're excited to learn what the screeners have produced. And based on that information found, we'll continue to make improvements and changes as needed on our project. Next slide, please. So on behalf of Montana APS, I want to thank everybody for joining. Thanks to the APS TARC in Nevada for having us on. It's been a pleasure.
Great. Thank you so much. My goodness, I told you they were the dream team. All right. So we do have time for some questions, and there are a couple that came in. So please go ahead and submit while we are chatting with the first couple. So What amount of training was needed for staff to use the various tools, and was it in person, virtual, a combination of both? So, Trevor?
So I can.
Yeah.
Yeah, for Montana, we had a couple all staff trainings, and we just went over the material, what the goal of the project was, why we were gathering this, just to get the buy-in from our staff. We had some role-playing scenarios, myself being one of them, so diving out of the comfort zone a little bit. But those were all staff trainings. And then we piloted it with one of our regions just to start it, to maybe identify some of those challenges that came up. So when we put it out to the rest of our regions throughout the state, we had some of those problems already figured out. We did partner with DCI, or Department of Criminal Investigations, on the DOJ side, and had their Narcotics Bureau chief give us some further training on recognizing opioid use and abuse, to include paraphernalia, side effects, that sort of thing. And really, it was just a work through. It was learning as we went in some scenarios, and adjusting as needed. And it's been a fairly smooth process after the first couple months.
So this is what with Nevada, you know, we did the same as Trevor talked about as far as training. Most of our training, though, was done virtually, because as we were just, you know, starting this, it was still not very many people coming into the office. And we did the same thing, like I said, the role playing. And then, you know, as staff went out into the field and using the screening tool, you know, we're really receptive of getting, you know, feedback. And so we would get feedback, and our team would meet, and if there was things we thought we should, you know, tweak a little bit. But with our state, we have four offices in Las Vegas, Reno, Carson City, and Elko. So we all, it was sent out and everyone started at the same time.
Great, thank you. So here's a question. Do you think case decision-making changed as a result of this additional information? And do you think outcomes are different for the case? Can the info you gather regarding the person of interest or alleged perpetrator use of opioids be used when cases are prosecuted? So that's a big mixed question. Who wants to tackle that?
This is Nevada. I just want to, Agnes and Sharysse are big with our report numbers. I don't know if they can answer questions, if anything, seen any changes between substantiation and unsubstantiated. I don't know, but I'll let them.
This is Agnes. Well, for Nevada, our numbers are, as you noticed, really low. So we're not able to do these questionnaires with any of our alleged perpetrators yet. So we'll have to wait and see what happens.
Great. Trevor?
I wouldn't say that this has changed. It's changed the outcome of our findings in a case. What it has changed a bit is the number of service plans that we've created. In any investigation, when our investigators are going out, if they see a need through their investigation, a service that could benefit the alleged victim or now the alleged perpetrator, they create a service plan for that. And this has increased our service plans in that if we do notice that there are some issues with opiates, they may create another service plan to get them help with treatment, whether it's a treatment facility or redirecting back to a medical professional to discuss treatment options. But I wouldn't say that it has changed our case outcome.
Great, thank you. Question, has there been any discussion regarding case managers or carrying Narcan?
This is Tammy with Nevada, and we did discuss that, or I discussed it with our leadership, and at the time is that our investigators, we would not be doing that.
Great, thank you.
Trevor?
Yeah, in Montana, we haven't asked that. That question hasn't been posed. It's not a bad idea, and I'm willing to pose the question and wait for the response.
Great, thank you. Okay, how and to whom did you refer when you found those who were misusing?
So this is Tammy again in Nevada. So our process is if during the questionnaire it is found that there is some misuse, we ask the client if they would be willing to have us do a referral to our mental health counselors. Like I said, Helen's in the north, Christy's in the south. And if they are willing, then Christy and Helen, they meet with the client and go over some resources in the community and offer to help them get them connected to these services.
And in Montana, there was there's a lot of referrals out to various treatment facilities based on location of the report and the alleged victim or alleged perp. We've made referrals back to medical professionals to help discuss treatment options with them. There was a new initiative launched in Montana just about a month or so ago, I believe, called the Angel Initiative. And that is that speaks directly to opioid abuse, and it allows somebody to self-report to a law enforcement agency, and then law enforcement will help them get connected with treatment facilities. So it also has triggered some referrals to our addictive and mental disorder division to help and see if they can be of service for the opioid use.
And here's kind of a question that's related as well. Were there any opioid related hotlines or numbers newly established or existing and updated for crisis situations? And if so, were any processes expedited when the triage determined the severity of the need and the time factors were extreme?
That's a great question. I don't know that
I don't know how to answer that.
I don't know that we created or had implemented any new hotlines. There is a hotline with the Angel Initiative that was just put out, and that was put out as a possible service that our investigators could put out there to these individuals that are in need. That's a great question, but there hasn't been any new developed hotlines other than our Angel Initiative.
Yeah, and this is Tammy again from Nevada, and then we use our resources through the resource guide that our mental health counselor researched and put on a just on a sheet of paper for our staff. So there's any new resources developed from this, we're using the existing out there.
Right. And if something is in a crisis situation, I would assume that 911 and others are called in. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you. Thank you so much. My goodness. Thank you for your great questions. We got to not all of them, but most of them. And if you have a specific question for any one of our presenters, the presenter introduction page, it does have everyone's email, or you can go ahead and email us at the TARC. Next slide. And with our last minute, I just want to thank Tammy, Agnes, Sharysse, and Trevor. You have been wonderful to work with. It's really inspiring to hear what you're doing. I hope your next part of this grant goes really well, and looking forward to the data and practice changes that are coming forward. I'd like to thank Andy Capehart of the TARC for running our slides, and I want to thank you for joining us and for all of your great questions. We hope to see you for the next APS TARC webinar for the greater APS field on March 15th, Equity and Cultural Humility in APS, beginning the conversation around staff and client experiences. Registration for that is open. Please email us if you'd like to attend and you have not seen the emails going around, and we can help get you registered for that. Enjoy the rest of your day and see you next time. Thank you, everyone.